Good evening, friends. I welcome all for the 27th webinar of Corporate Professional. To share knowledge is the best donation for any human being. And we are making this effort to share knowledge and remove doubts on various topical issues from the minds of professional and corporate India. Our method of sharing knowledge coupled with question answer session after every program, we are getting lots of encouragement and lots of support from your side about this methodology. And this encourages us to do more and more program on topical interest. When Savitri talked to me about the MC, program of listing of NCDs, then I thought this topic is okay, but I'm surprised when I saw the registration is more than 983. So it means there are lots of people, those who want to clear their doubts, and there must be some issues in the NCD. Maybe they want to understand this concept, maybe they want to clear their doubts also. So today we have we have invited speakers who have practical knowledge. We have invited regulator who has a prospect to tell us that why this NCD issues are there and what are the things, and solve the doubts in the minds of all the participants. Today we have invited Savitri Parekh. Savitri Parekh, I think everybody knows her now. She is having an experience of 25 years and she's working currently Joint Company Secretary and Compliance Officer of Reliance Industries. She has authored books on corporate law and is specialist editor to a Ramaiya Guide to Companies Act. No doubt she has edited Ramaiya, but she is our Chalta Firta Ramaiya. Savitri knows not only knows the sections, but she knows section, subsection, and then again subsections. It is on her fingertips. She was a government nominee on the Council of ICSI, and she has been a member of SS Secretary Standard Board. And she has also been a guest faculty of IIM Calcutta and various other professional forum. She is regular speaker at various programs organized by Chartered Accountant, Company Secretary, Chamber of Commerce. She attends with the Bombay Chamber also. I welcome Savitri for this program of this NCD, and we will definitely learn lots of insight from Savitri about this particular issues which she has managed. Then we have Pradeep Ramakrishnan. She will join just now. Pradeep Ramakrishnan is a general manager of SEBI. Recently, he shifted to this bond division. Actually, we call Pradeep as a bond. He is our James Bond, who has a different types of perception, knowledge, and implementable strategy. He was in corporate earlier, even CFD, and he has done lots of changes during COVID time and lots of changes in corporate governance. So we expect Pradeep will do wonders here. He's qualified company secretary and he has experience of more than 20 years in SEBI. He is one of the finest officer in SEBI who thinks differently. We welcome him for this program and we learn something new from you. Then we have Anjali Agrawal. She's a partner in Corporate Professional. She is a head of capital market division of Corporate Professional. Anjali has an experience of more than 25 years. She was working earlier in Delhi Stock Exchange and she has experience in capital market and various transactions, various buyback, delisting, direct listing, NCD listing, listing work she has done in a different and in a perfect manner. So I welcome Anjali for this program. Friends, as you are aware, this is one topic where everybody wants to learn something. Now, if I can see that, what is the international capital market on bond global bond market in terms of US dollar, it is $128 trillion US dollar. Out of this, $40.9 trillion dollar is a corporate bond, which represents 32% of entire bond market. Remaining is sovereign bond, that is SSA, that is there. But now you can understand, when we compare something, we compare with the international scenario. What is India's position? India's GDP is 2.94 trillion. That is 2.29% of global market, global bond market. Now, Indian bond market is developing, but it is not developed this way. 67% of Indian GDP is debt market. Out of this, only 16% is bond. If I compare this 16% with other countries which are not very developed, like Malaysia, they have a 46%. South Korea, there is 73%. The reason is that because of the low penetration and unstable trading is the reason of this. Now, if I just see this, that how this listing a non-convertible debenture nuances and compliances, then you will find that the issue is connected to this. Anjali, can you open the PPT?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So you can understand that there are so many nuances and compliances issues are there. And you will realize this, that today, if you go to the market for not listing of NCD, then we have two types of securities, equity, preferential, and debenture. Equity, we know private placement can take place, right issue, IPO and FPO. And when we talk about the debentures or bond market, we have a convertible debenture, we have a non-convertible, we have municipal bond, we have a green bond, which is a new concept, government securities, various other things are there in the debenture and the NCD market. Then we have a preferential, redeemable preferential, non-redeemable, convertible, various permutation combination are there. This is the actually fundraising process. Now, in the fundraising, if you see the comparison, that what is Indian market, so you can realize this, there is a private placement, there is a public issue of NCD and bond market. And this comparative, the private placement is a larger as compared to equity, because in equity, public issue is more, but in the NCD and bond, the private placement is far ahead than this. So you can see 6,75,000 crore the private placement has taken place of NCD and bond market. Equity is only 1.62. So if you see the public issue, then 15,146 public issue is there for NCD market and 94,000 crore is equity. So you can just understand that the market for few player is good. And I have some questions which I will ask when Pradeep will join us in the question answer session. The public issue is not that popular, and this is confined to few people, but the market is going up and things are moving up. Now, why people are choosing NCD or debenture or this NCD issue as compared to equity? Okay. So the simple logic is suitability. Suitability is that for listed as well as unlisted company, private or public, best suited for high fund requirement project cap like infrastructure. That is one, because you can get a higher fund. Sophisticated investors are there, because in this NCD market or bond market, only banks and institutions are there. They can invest. Liquidity, listed NCD has a good liquidity where investor can exit at any time through stock exchange. That's why this instrument is becoming more and more popular. Then tax saving, interest payable on NCD is tax deductible expenditure. That is a part where tax saving is taking place. Then less compliances as compared to equity market, compliances are less. Then visibility is higher, because if the listing in CD is there, then public can see, is a transparent system, and the market can see what is happening. And the most important thing, whenever you are raising fund through equity, you have a fear of diluting your control. But here in the equity market, in the debt market, you are not losing this, that is there. Because of these reasons, NCD market is becoming popular and these things are taking shape. So today, this is the background which I have given. Now, the program structure is this. After me, Anjali will take you and tell us the compliance process, how the NCD can be issued. Then Pradeep Ramakrishnan will suggest us regulatory aspects and the new development. Then Savitri will take up the industry prospects and the new circular and new changes which has taken place. Then we will have a question answer. Anybody has any questions, please write to us. We will raise this issue during the question answer session. Over to Anjali to tell us about this, how to issue NCD, what are the compliance, how to make it. Over to Anjali.
Thank you so much, sir. So from the numbers as Pawan sir shared in the initial slides, we can very well make out that the definitely over the last 5-6 years, the NCD markets has gained momentum, and there are various reasons as attributable to this, as Pawan sir told. Some of the other reasons can be an NCD issuance, to my understanding, is a win-win security, both from the company's point of view, issuer's point of view, as well as from the investor's point of view. Investors get better return, better yield. There is a fixed tenure. The credit rating is there. So comparatively, the investors feel secured that the instrument has been approved, has been vetted by agency, by a agency which is registered with SEBI. So these securities are better off as compared to any other mode of fundraising. So when we talk about NCDs, the legal framework as applicable in Indian scenario is, number one, the Companies Act. Then we have a regulations called issue and listing of debt securities regulations. This is the regulation of 2008. Then the FEMA provisions are applicable, and the SEBI listing regulations are again a very important set of compliance regulations which are needed to be kept in mind once the company is listed. I went through the profile of the people who are attending today's program, and I found that there are many a private limited companies who have decided. I plan to go in with a little bit of more details so that the private limited companies or first time issuers can understand where exactly are they and are they eligible for a fundraising by way of NCDs or not. So NCDs, there can be both public issue as well as private placement. So now the basic question that comes to mind is why anybody would want to go in for listing of NCDs when unlisted securities or unlisted NCDs are also allowed, but why would anybody want to go in for listing? Number one, easy exit to the investors. That's a very important point from the point of view of the investors. Then uninterrupted funding to the corporates. Corporates get a regular funding through by way of regular issuances of NCDs. And a very important aspect is listed NCDs, even if unsecured, will not be treated as deposits. Otherwise, if an unsecured NCD is issued by any company, that will be considered as deposits under the provisions of Companies Act, and the company will have to comply with the provisions of deposit rules. Another important aspect, which though not covered in this slide, is the tax, which is the interest which is paid to the NCD holders. No TDS is deducted on the listed NCDs. That again is a very important aspect from the point of view of the investors, that there will not be any tax deduction at source. Now, when we talk about public issue of NCDs, what is a public issue? Public issue, like the way we talk about equity market, just like that in NCD market, it is raising of funds from the public at large by issuance of these marketable securities to meet some business objectives. What is the basic brief life cycle of public issue of any NCDs? The company has to appoint the intermediaries, being the merchant banker, debenture trustees. Then the merchant banker will conduct a due diligence exercise. A draft letter of offer is prepared, which is needed to be filed with the stock exchanges and SEBI for record purposes only. Then this offer document is kept open for public comments for a period of 7 working days. We need to obtain an in-principle approval from the stock exchanges. Then listing agreement is signed with the stock exchanges, concerned stock exchanges. It's not mandatory to list the NCDs on both the stock exchanges, BSE as well as NSE. The company may decide to either go in for BSE or NSE or even both. then filing of the letter of offer with SEBI along with the due diligence certificate from the merchant banker and also from the debenture trustee. The issue is opened, the allotment is made, and listing and trading applications are made to the stock exchanges. Now, a big question that may arise, that may come to everybody's mind, is that in equity public issue, there is a concept called minimum subscription. But is it so in NCD public issue as well? No, it is not mandatory. Issuer may decide. Issuers are free to decide upon the minimum subscription limit. And while coming out with a public issue of NCDs, the company has to keep in mind that NCD cannot be raised for providing loan to a group company or acquisition of shares of the same group. That is an important restriction which has been placed upon the public issues of NCDs. Now coming to the private placement, which is as shown in the initial tables as well, public issues size is comparatively much lesser as compared to private placement of the NCDs or the bonds market. There are reasons to it because again, people find public issue comparatively cumbersome and private placement a simplified process of raising funds. The regulatory regime as applicable under the Companies Act. Companies Act is the Bible for every company. So we have to follow the provisions of Companies Act. Section 42 read with Rule 14 of the Companies Prospectus and Allotment of Securities. Section 42, we call it a mother section, and which is applicable for any kind of further allotment, any kind of securities being issued. Then Section 71, read with Rule 18 of Companies Share Capital and Debenture Rules is needed to be followed. This talks about the issuance of debentures and creation of the debenture redemption reserve. I'll be taking these concepts in the coming slides. Then Section 181C of the Companies Act, that is the power of the board, board means board of directors, to borrow from borrow. So for any private placement, as a general rule, we require a shareholder's approval by way of a special resolution. This is the requisite of Section 42. But in case of NCD issuance, if the company has passed a resolution under Section 180, sub-regulation 1, sub-regulation C, that is the power to borrow, and if the amount to be borrowed, to be raised, plus amount already borrowed is less than the paid-up share capital plus free reserves and share premium account, then no special resolution under Section 42 is needed to be passed. Only a board resolution under Section 179(3)(c) is required to be passed under the Companies Act. 179(3)(c) is to raise securities from time to time. But if the amount already borrowed plus the amount proposed to be raised is greater than the paid up share capital and the free reserves and securities premium of the company, then a blanket approval. This exemption is applicable, this relaxation is applicable only in case of NCD issuances. A blanket approval can be taken for all the issuances which will be valid for a period of one financial year. You don't have to take a fresh resolution. You don't have to go to shareholders again and again. You propose to raise the funds. So now what all approvals are required for issue or listing of the NCDs? First of all, as we discussed, a board approval under Section 179 of the Companies Act, that is a mandatory thing. It is required to be obtained from the board of directors. The company has to obtain the in-principle approval from the stock exchanges. Then a shareholder's approval under Section 42 would not be required, but a shareholder's resolution, shareholder's approval under Section 181(c) would still be required, depending upon the situation where we are in. Now, whether it's a public issue of NCDs or a private placement of NCDs, there are certain intermediaries which are mandatorily needed to be appointed. These are needed to be appointed either under the Companies Act or under the SEBI debt regulations. First of all, being the debenture trustee. He is mandatory to be appointed. Debenture trustee is registered with SEBI. It's a entity which is registered with SEBI. then the company has to appoint a registrar and share transfer agent, because the NCDs can be issued only in DMAT mode. Then in case there is a concept called e-book mechanism, e-book mechanism is applicable for issuances of private placement of NCDs where the issue size is more than 200 crores. So there is an arranger is needed to be appointed for the same. Arranger includes merchant bankers or RBI registered primary dealers or any other intermediaries as may be notified by SEBI. They enter and upload the bids on behalf of the investors. Credit rating agency is the company has to obtain credit rating for the proposed debentures needed to be proposed to be issued. Credit rating agency again is registered with SEBI, and ebook provider, ebook platform is needed to be taken. This can be either BSE or NSE. So when we talk about all these intermediaries to be appointed, we'll have to enter into documentation with them. We'll have to enter into agreements with them. So first of all, disclosure document is needed to be prepared. Disclosure document is the offer document or the private placement offer document, we call it. This is needed to be prepared in terms of Schedule 1 of the SEBI debt regulations and also as per Form PAS 4 of the Companies Act. Then debenture trustee agreement, wherein the trustee gives his consent to act as the trustee for the proposed issue, and this is needed to be executed prior to the closure of the offer. Then debenture trust deed is needed to be entered into, which is to be executed within 2 months from the allotment. It needs to be as near as possible in the format as set out in the debenture rules. Then credit rating letter, the credit rating agency will issue, first of all, they'll issue a in principle rating, and then they'll issue a final rating. The ratings have to be disclosed, and the rationale for the same is needed to be disclosed. Then depository agreement is needed to be entered into. It's a tripartite agreement between the company, between the RTA, and between the depositories. And listing agreement with the concerned stock exchange, where the company proposes to go in for listing. Then, as I said, ebook mechanism is there. Ebook mechanism is applicable for issue sizes of more than 200 crores, more than equal to 200 crores. Earlier, this limit was 500 crores. And ever since 2018, this limit has been reduced to 200 crores. It's a bidding wherein the various parties, various bidders can bid at the platform. Bidding takes place during the working hours, that is from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. on any of the working days. The issuer may withdraw the issue. However, if any issuer withdraws the issue, then it will not be allowed to access the e-book mechanism platform for a period of 7 days from such withdrawal. And the participants prior to entering into the bidding process are required to enroll themselves with the ebook platform. The object of bringing this mechanism is to achieve better transparency and better price discovery for the private placement of the NCDs. Now, what exactly are the steps involved? The earlier what we discussed till now were the provisions as applicable under the Companies Act and the debt regulations, but how to move ahead, how to decide whether we can go ahead with NCD issuance or not. First of all, we have to check whether we are meeting with the eligibility requirements for issuance and listing of the NCDs. So the company has to obtain credit rating from at least one of the credit rating agencies. There is no requirement, no specific rating which is needed to be obtained, but we need to obtain a rating. This is a requirement which arises from the debt regulations as well as from the Companies Act. There cannot be more than 200 investors in a financial year. This is the basic requirement of a Companies Act. The debt securities proposed to be listed have to be mandatorily in the DMAT form only. This is as per the debt regulations. Physical issuances of debt securities is not allowed. Then prior appointment of debenture trustee. A debenture trustee is needed to be appointed in the very first meeting itself, this is a requirement of Companies Act as well as the debt regulations. NCDs may be issued in denominations with minimum 5 lakh rupee face value and in multiples of rupee 1 lakh. This is the requirement arising from the RBI guidelines. And the tenure of the NCDs can be a maximum of 10 years from the date of issue, or in case of infrastructure projects, because it can be 30 years. In case of infrastructure projects, one can very well understand that the projects and the gestation period involved in that project is comparatively on a very high side. That's why this tenure has been kept at maximum 30 years. This is a requirement of Companies Act. Now, NSE has a set of eligibility criteria. BSE presently do not have any such criteria. NSE still has. NSE mandates that public limited companies or private limited companies should have the paid up capital of at least 10 crores or market capitalization of at least 25 crores. And in case of unlisted companies, that means wherein even equity is not listed, the net worth should be more than 25 crores. Credit rating remains there. Credit rating has still to be obtained. And for infrastructure companies, they have a specific requirement that the company, that it qualifies for listing under the respective acts, rules and regulations under which the securities are being issued. Scores registration is a mandatory aspect. We cannot do listing without a scores registration with SEBI. Then we need to conduct a board meeting to consider and approve the raising of the funds through the NCDs. We need to apply to NSDL CDSL for obtaining the DMAT connectivity, or we call it ISIN number. Then obtaining of credit rating, we need to appoint the debenture trustee, and approval of the draft disclosure document is there. We need to obtain ISIN numbers from the depositories. Herein, a very important aspect to be kept in mind as a practical aspect towards the NCD issuances, we need to obtain different ISINs in case the redemption dates are different. If the redemption dates are same, but the date of allotment is different, no issues at all. The common ISIN would do. But in case the redemption dates are different, we need to obtain different separate ISIN numbers for each of the issuances. Application to the stock exchanges for their in-principle approval. Shareholders' approval, as I've already explained, is not required under Section 42. But if we have to take the blanket approval, then a shareholders' approval would be required. Obtaining final credit rating from the credit rating agency. The next step would be allotment of NCDs. Then executing the corporate action for admission of NCDs with the depositories, filing of listing cum trading applications with the stock exchanges, and execution of the debenture trustee. As I told you in the initial documents to be prepared, this is needed to be prepared within 2 months from the date of closure. Now, once we are listed on the stock exchanges, till now, we were an unlisted company. We had a specific pattern of doing the compliances. We were looking into the compliances only under the Companies Act. But once we are a listed entity, we fall within the ambit of SEBI listing regulations as well. And so, once we are listed, there may happen a situation wherein my equity as well as my debt is listed, or there may be a situation wherein only my debt is listed. So if my debt as well as equity is listed, then Chapter 3, which is common obligations, is needed to be complied with. Chapter 4, which is the equity chapter, will be applicable in full. We have to comply it in full. Chapter 5, the debt chapter, is needed to be complied with to the extent the disclosures have not been made in the equity chapter. And there is a circular of 26 November 2018, which mandates for mandatory debt funding to the extent of 25%. I'll be taking up this particular circular in the coming slides. Then in case my only NCD is listed, Chapter 3 common obligations would still be applicable. Chapter 4, equity chapter would not apply to me. Chapter 5, debt chapter applies in full. And the 26th November 2018 circular is still applicable. Now, this is a circular of November 2018, which is to be implemented in phases. And it talks about mandatory borrowings by large corporates by way of issuance of debt securities. A large corporate has been defined as a company whose equity either is equity shares, debentures, preference shares are listed on any of the stock exchanges, and the long-term borrowings are greater than equal to 100 crores, and credit rating of 100 double A above is there, which has been assigned by any of the rating agencies. Then only it will fall within the ambit of large corporate and it will have to comply with this circular. So as per this circular, minimum 25% of the long-term borrowings during the current financial year, that is incremental borrowings, are to be raised by way of issuance of debt securities. And these debt securities will be listed on the stock exchanges in terms of the SEBI debt listing regulations. Some of the routine compliances which are needed to be kept in mind under the provisions of listing regulations. If any, the intimation for payment of interest or redemption amount at least 11 working days before the due date, the intimation is needed to be given. Then intimation for declaration or recommendation for fresh issuances of NCDs at least 2 clear working days before the date of the meeting is needed to be given. Then half yearly or annual results plus the statement of deviations is needed to be filed within 45 days or 60 days of the end of the half year or the final financial year. Then maintenance of 100% asset cover or as mentioned in the disclosure document, this is needed to be maintained at all times. Now, this is a recent amendment which has taken place. Till this amendment came in, the requirement was maintenance of 100% asset cover. Now this has been amended to the tune that as mentioned in the disclosure document. So if the disclosure document says that 60% of the asset cover would be maintained, so then it can be maintained to that extent. Then review of credit rating at least once a year is needed to be undertaken, and furnishing of the documents to the debenture trustee. This is again is a new requirement which has taken place. This is needed to be given from the statutory auditor with regard to the asset cover. It is needed to be given every half year. Then certificate to the stock exchanges for timely payment of interest or principal amounts. This is needed to be given within 2 days from the due date, and record date intimation for payment of interest or principal within 7 working days. This is a prior requirement, where prior 7 working days it is needed to be given. So these were the nuances and compliances involved in the NCD issuance for a listed entity or for an unlisted entity. Now over to Savitri for discussing the recent amendments that have taken place. Over to you, Savitri.
Anjali, Pradeep.
Yeah. Pradeep. Okay, he has joined.
Pradeep is joining.
Okay.
Savitri, I think Pradeep is joining. So, Pradeep, are you there?
Oh, sir, he is joining in 2 minutes.
Okay. Savitri, can I just ask this question? This, because now SEBI has come out with circular on 8th recently.
That's right, 8th of October.
So what are the main thing they have covered in this? Till Pradeep is coming, you can just tell, then you can take up after the Pradeep.
Sure. First of all, thank you very much, Pavan. The kind of participation that you mentioned for this particular seminar is very overwhelming. And my sincere thanks to all the registrants as well as the participants. Coming back to your question, Pavan, on the changes. If you actually see, the changes have been made in 3 regulations. One is in the SEBI Debenture Trustees Regulation. The other one is in provisions of LODR. And the third is in ILDS. Now, if you see the kind of changes that have been made in all three, they kind of marry together and are intertwined. If I were to put it in one sentence, I would say that the obligation and duties of the debenture trustees have been enhanced. The responsibility with respect to asset cover, which is on the issuer, has also been made a little more stringent. Provisions of transparency have been fully brought in. And when I say it has been asset cover related provisions have got stringent, I mean that there is this certificate from statutory auditors, which was covered by Anjali, has also been mandated. Even if you actually see the changes vis-a-vis what was earlier there, at some places, they may appear to be marginal changes, but in terms of depth, it is quite substantial. For example, if you look at the amendments which have been made to the debenture trustee regulations, there are principally two changes in Regulation 14 and in Regulation 15. Regulation 14 deals with obligations of the debenture trustees, 15 deals with duties of the debenture trustees. Now, if you see in 14, they have basically aligned the provisions with Section 71 of the Companies Act 2013 and requirements of SH12. Actually, these two were already there in the debenture trustee regulations. What has now been brought in is this Part A, Part B, which is the way a debenture trust deed should look like. Part A is for all the statutory standard clauses with respect to the debenture trust deed, and Part B will relate to the specific clauses which are applicable to the issue at hand, which basically means a debenture trust deed would be very easy to read with these two clearly identified parts, Part A and Part B. That's the main change in Regulation 14. If you then move over to Regulation 15, there are changes mainly with respect to, there are two main changes, I would say, 15.1H and 15.1T. Now, 15.1H basically is one where the trustee will have to ensure implementation of creation of security. So basically, the responsibility of ensuring creation of security, DRR, and expense recovery fund has been put on the trustee. Now, if you see the old provision already covered is this particular expense recovery fund, recovery of expense fund, which is a new provision which has been added in ILDS. In Regulation 26 of ILDS, there is this particular provision which has been introduced, and that responsibility has now been put on the trustee by virtue of Regulation 15.1H. The other change is in 15.1T. If you look at 15.1T, the change once again is incremental in the sense that if the security for the debentures is by way of receivables or book debts, if the security created is on the receivables or book debts, then the debenture trustee shall carry out its own due diligence. This is a new provision. The due diligence has to be carried out by the debenture trustees themselves in such manner as may be prescribed, so as to be assuring itself that there is sufficient asset cover. Now, asset cover, as Anjali mentioned, should be 100%, or as is mentioned in the disclosure, there are three provisions here, as is mentioned in the offer document, or in the information memorandum, or in the debenture trust deed. So it is 100% or these three. Now, I would just like to add, and possibly we could have a bit of discussion on that later, is it cannot be less than 100% according to me. It can only be more than 100% and not less than 100%, because if it's a listed debenture, LODR very clearly mandates maintenance of 100%. Of course, but with this language, there is room for interpretation as to whether a lower asset cover is acceptable. a lower asset cover, in my opinion, will not actually be acceptable because Section 71 of the Companies Act gives right to the debenture trustees to file an application before NCLT, where it says at any time during the tenure of the debentures, if the asset cover is less than the amount that is required for meeting the principal and interest thereon, the debenture trustees can move NCLT. Hence, I would hold a view that it can only be 100 plus and not 100 minus, because it should be sufficient to take care of this. Otherwise, the principal provisions of the Companies Act will come into play. However, I would also add, just as Anjali said, can it be lower? I would hold a view it cannot be lower. Coming back to 15.1t, the debenture trustee, as I said, needs to do a due diligence on its own. And on a half year, this is on a quarterly basis, the trustee does this. On a half yearly basis, the debenture trustees should obtain a certificate from the statutory auditors. Now, once again, if you see these provisions, earlier also there was these provision, but there was a bit of a concession as to who could give this certificate. The certificate earlier on a quarterly basis could have been given by the managing director or by the director of the company, and on a yearly basis, any independent chartered accountant or practicing company secretary could give it, which has now been replaced by statutory auditor giving such a certificate. So therefore, the asset cover which the trustee needs to be assured of has now become a continuous compliance, which has to be validated once a quarter. And also there is a certificate given on a half yearly basis, and this half yearly certificate has to be given along with the financial results. Now these are basically 15.1t. The certificate which is required will have to be submitted to the trustees, and the trustees will have to ensure that this valuation, the value of the receivables, is definitely more than what it should be. Now, coming back to the certificate of the statutory auditor, the obligation has actually gone up. It is not just about the value of the receivables or of the book debts. It covers confirmation on satisfactory compliance of the covenants which have been given. Now, if you see in Schedule 1 of ILDS, covenants are also required to be disclosed. Covenants as well as risk factors are required to be disclosed. Now, this certificate of the statutory auditor is also required to confirm whether all these covenants have been satisfied. In fact, if you look at the breach condition also covers all the conditions which have been mentioned either in the offer document or in the information memorandum or in the debenture trust deed, which actually means it is not just financial breach. Even an incipient one, which may otherwise come up, is also required to be disclosed. One of the other changes, which is not just about the debenture trustee regulations, but is actually in the ILDS and in the disclosure document, is one where side letters have also been asked to be disclosed. I think Pradeep has joined, so I would actually like to stop over here. I've just covered debenture trustee regulations, and it's good that Pradeep is here now. So let me hand over to Pradeep and come in a little later once again. Over to you, Pavan.
Yeah, Pradeep, I welcome Pradeep. Pradeep, your slide is visible. Yeah. So you can start, please.
Yeah. First of all, apologies. I seem to be always running into problems with technical issues with most of the meetings I attend. It actually causes a lot more havoc than the meeting itself. So sorry for the delay. Unfortunately, it has also eaten up into my time, which I already had set aside for this. So without much ado, I'll just go into the small presentation that I have prepared. So I was handling the equity portion of compliance probably till a month back. So I have moved into the Department of Debt and Hybrid Securities. So this is my first presentation, so I should thank Pavan and CP for this opportunity. The views here are mine and they've got nothing to do with SEBI, so that it's a mandatory disclaimer that I have to start with. Okay, so now as far as the corporate bond market is concerned, we essentially corporate bond market refers to different types of instruments. You have corporate bonds, you have G-Secs, largely regulated by the Reserve Bank of India. You have commercial paper, you have municipal bonds and securitized debt instruments, which are yet to take off in a big way in India. So there are certain regulations which we have, because since it's a very nascent regulation, so if you look at the equity side of it, we have been having regulations right since 1992. So though we have had sporadic circulars, only in 2008 did we first come out with the regulation for debt, and we brought in something called the issue of listing and issue and listing of debt securities regulations. And for quite some time, there wasn't much listing. Now that the complexities of of this market being a lot more, so many things which we have come in and a lot of new instruments also coming in, I think this is an exciting sphere to be in. You must also have seen the budget announcements of the government this year and a couple of years back, right since 2016 onwards also, there has been a lot of focus on the corporate bond market with the mandatory that the 25% of, for certain companies they mentioned around 25% of your borrowings should be from the corporate bond market. So this is all a push which is being made, so that this is a source of capital which a lot of people could perhaps tap because of the flexibility available. This could also boost the trading in the corporate bond market, because though India is an important player in the corporate bond market as far as the number of money raised as well as the trades are concerned, it's still very nascent as far as the bigger countries like perhaps US are concerned. So we have been trying our best, and I think it will continue to further the development of the bond market. So there is another regulation called the non-convertible redeemable preference shares regulation. So this is also something. So if you look at the ICDR applies to specified securities. Specified securities are always, are equity shares and convertibles. So anything that is a non-convertible instrument comes under the ILDS apart from debt. But if you see the NCRPS regulations, they're essentially a mirror of the ILDS regulations, not much of a difference. Largely, they contain the same provisions. Now, as far as compliance is concerned, all of you must be familiar with the LODR. That is something which a lot of listed companies in the equity space comply with. Now, LODR also contains around 20 odd sections, regulations for compliance by bond listed companies. So they essentially also have a 6-month compliance for financials and other watered down. There is no corporate governance requirement. Corporate governance requirements are also, are not mandatory for debt listed companies. So in this context, I would also like to speak on one particular portion of the amendment which has come recently. That is, I think we have been receiving a lot of queries also on that. Section 252 of the Companies Act, where they have specifically mentioned in the Act amendment that, they've said that a debt listed company would mean a company which is, the private limited debt listed companies. If you go to the Company Law Committee report, I think it was submitted in 2018, I think it was formed in 2016. I think the background to that is that I think there were representations made to the MCA that, there are compliances for companies which are only privately placed their debt by private limited companies is something which they wouldn't want to do. Because if you look at the Companies Act, the requirement as regards independent directors, audit committee, nomination, remuneration committee, etc., which are applicable to all listed companies. And if you look at the definition of listed company under the Companies Act, it says that every company that is listed its securities on a stock exchange in India. So it leads us to a sort of a dichotomous situation where the SEBI LODR provisions don't prescribe corporate governance requirements, but the Companies Act prescribes corporate governance requirements. So from that angle, I think there were representations made that at least private limited listed companies should not be subject to that. Of course, now if you look at the provision which has come, it says that the government, that is MCA, will exempt companies, a class of companies after consultation with SEBI. So, but as far as SEBI is concerned, SEBI is, pretty clear that the ILDS and NCRPS will continue to apply to companies which want to list their shares, list their bonds. So there is no leeway as far as listing is concerned, because once you enter into the listed space, the regulations which have to be complied with are your ILDS and NCRPS and the LODR as applicable. So that is something which I would like to make clear. So we also have the municipal bonds regulations. I think that's a pretty exciting space also, because municipalities need a lot of money, and one important place to tap for money would be the bond market. We recently had an issue by the Lucknow Municipal Corporation. I think that also should be has been a success. So that should also open up the market for other municipalities to come in, because this is a space which they can also tap. So we also have the securitization, listing of securitized instruments, but that is something which is in its nascent stage. Though the regulations have been issued quite some time back, I think it's safe to take off.
Pradeep, can you just speak little bit louder?
Yeah, I'll do that. Yeah, fine. You see, am I fine now?
I see. Now it is better.
Yeah, fine. I'm so sorry. I think I was whispering. It's in the end of day. I'm pretty too tired. I got a little too bogged on by the fact that I couldn't connect for quite some time. So, yeah. So, okay. Now we'll go to what is contained in the ILDS regulations. The ILDS regulations, as I said, it contains the regulatory framework for issue of and listing of corporate bonds. And as you know, that is a disclosure regime. SEBI has always, SEBI has been the usherer of a disclosure regime. We are not a merit-based regime, and there are certain disclosures which you have to make. So unlike the equity space, in case of debt, there is no issue of observations by SEBI. You have to appoint a merchant banker, make the disclosures. It is obtained, put on the website on the stock exchange for 7 working days, and on the basis of changes, etc., then you can go ahead and the thing gets listed. So it's applicable to both private placement and public issue. There are a couple of requirements on private placement which we come recently, which I'll tell as I go forth. So credit rating requirement, there is no minimum rating criteria, though you'll have to disclose all the ratings that you have obtained. And there's a concept of shell prospectus, which comes from section 31 of the Companies Act, which says that for multiple issues of bonds, then you may file a shell prospectus. The right to recall or redeem is there, and that is something which you have to state upfront in the offer document, which was not there in the case of 81 bonds, about which I'll speak again later. NCRPS regulations, it's largely follows the similar template as the ILDS regulations. So it says that up to 20 years, because more than that you can't do it. However, for for infrastructure, then based companies, then you can issue preference shares for a period where you can redeem after 20 years also. So essentially, it's a disclosure-based regime, as I said earlier, and it's also applicable to public issue and private placement. Now, tier two instruments is something which are also permitted, even that of NBFCs, of PDIs. So even here, there is only a filing of offer document. There is no, there is only a filing with SEBI. No observations are issued, and you also need to create a capital redemption reserve. Now, the LODR, as I told you, the LODR contains provisions. So it's, you need to get registered with ISIN, and then there are certain provisions of the LODR which are applicable. It's largely a diluted thing as compared to the equity segment. The equity segment contains a lot more stringent list of provisions, including corporate governance. If you look at sections, regulations 15 to 27, 36 and 46 and all those things, there are very intense regulatory compliances for equity. Whereas for debt, it is a little watered down, though I think it has been there for quite some time, like, and there's a possibility it could perhaps be, it may need revisiting, because I think it's been around for quite some time the same way. Because, one of the arguments which we have been receiving is that if equity, which does not constitute any repayment, in a very rudimentary manner of arguing, if it requires corporate governance requirements, then why not debt? But I think at that point in time, the larger purpose was to ensure that debt should be listed. So the listing of debt was predominant. So I would like to stop here and also talk about one issue which has recently cropped up. It's about the filing of private placement related issues with financials of less than 3 years. So I believe there were issues earlier where companies were trying to, were filing issue with issues, because the idea was, if you have been in existence and other issues were there with the stock exchanges, and I believe stock exchanges have allowed listing for companies which have filed financials for less than 3 years. So, and profitability criteria. So that is something which we have now frowned upon, and we have made stock exchanges to change that stance. And now it will be that you need to ensure that it is there. The idea behind this whole issue is that, see, when you take it equity, look at equity, we have been receiving a lot of representations on this issue. So we have responded to them, and I'm trying to explain that to this webinar. So in case of equity, when there is no you know, compulsion for repayment, when there we insist on a 3-year financial in case you come through the profitability route, otherwise which you failing which you are forced to go through the mandatory QIB route where you have to, you know, offer it to QIBs. 90% of the issue needs to be offered to the QIBs. This is something where the repayment capacity of the company is paramount. That is the reason why, because when I'm going to put in money, your company guarantees repayment. That's a primary difference between a bond and equity instrument, in a manner of speaking, which is why we have insisted on the 3-year financials. However, if you see, there is we have sort of given one or two exemptions in as much to the period of financials. In case, suppose you have been incorporated in July or something for that matter, you can perhaps give financials from July to July. I mean, you know, you need not wait for 9 more months to file, because then it happens a 3-year and 9-month financials which you have to file. So that is something which we have sort of relaxed, which means that if you're in existence for 3 years and if you're able to file financials for 3 years, I think there is no problem. It has happened in a couple of cases. So that is a leeway which we have sort of given. So information has to be given to debenture trustees. Recently, if you see, the market intermediaries and regulatory and supervision division of SEBI has been issuing circulars. I think we are expecting some more circulars also on the responsibilities of debenture trustees, including monitoring. Largely, the debenture trustees have a huge role to perform because of the fact that debenture is an instrument which is sort of indirectly guaranteed by the company to repay, which is why the monitoring of debenture trustees is of paramount importance. So we have been coming out with a lot of circulars on the role of debenture trustees. So that's perhaps going to continue. So I'll just give you a small snapshot as to the collections. You know, if you see, it has gone up, including private placement as well as public. So this is gives you a snapshot. I think I'll share this PPT with CP and Pawan so that they can share this with you. It gives a snapshot as to the number of private placements and the amount listing. It's actually going up, and we believe, obviously, this is a sphere which can grow. It can only grow. It can only go up and exponentially, so which we believe it will happen. Now, if you look at the secondary market trade, I'll just give you a snapshot as to what exactly happens in the secondary market, what we have tried to do. So one thing is that the secondary market trades have also gone up, so if you see, and the amount which is involved has also gone up. So we only expect this, again, as I said, as far as the issues are concerned. Similarly, secondary market also, we expect it to go up. And I'll just give you a snapshot as to what we have tried to bring here as far as secondary market trade is concerned. So now, first going back to the primary market, we brought in this this reform on electronic book platform, where, because largely if you see, it's more an OTC dominant. It is still an OTC dominant market, and it is largely dominated by private placement. So we introduced this EBP, electronic book platform, which is essentially just like whereby there is electronic switching and electronic matching of a thing instead of something which is behind the screen. The opacity was a little too much. So this completely throws open the ball, throws open the ground open for everyone to apply. So there is a sophisticated bilateral negotiation between the buyer and the seller, and when there is an issue of debtor securities on a private placement basis, we expect this to reduce time and cost and bring in a lot of transparency and efficiency also in price discovery. However, this is applicable for all private placements the size of more than 200 crores. So we'll probably extend it over a period of time, looking at the success. At present, we are finding that this is taking off in a big way. So NSE and BSE are presently the electronic book platform providers. So if you see, in the last few years, almost 11 lakh crores have been raised to the electronic book platform, which is a testimony to its success. The other one which I was talking about is the request for quote platform. The request for quote platform is for the secondary market, where we have said that it can be through quotes from different several participants, it can happen. So we launched this recently, and now we have also mandated mutual funds to at least undertake 10% of the secondary market trades on the RFQ platform, which should give a huge fillip to it. And all regulated entities and institutional investors are eligible to participate on this. The advantage of this is that just like your electronic switching, etc., which happens in equity, this also gives flexibility to initiate quotes anonymously with identity, etc., and entire market. It also helps you to choose the deal parameters, etc. It is essentially aimed at replicating the OTC market on the electronic platform, so that we are able to bridge the whole problem which has arisen. So efficiently, it gives you efficient price discovery. So this is a new thing which has come, and we believe this will certainly take off in a big way. So these are things which will give a huge fillip to the corporate bond market in general. The one recent reform which we have brought about is the 81 bonds, which you would have seen recently, even the Madras High Court ruled. See, one thing, I just have to take a step back and then I will tell you about investment, whether it is in bond or equity. It is something which SEBI has always been harping upon. The fact is that the investor is as much responsible for investment as the regulator is, as the issuer is. So that is that is something which you can't run away from. So in case of 81 bonds, if you see, I mean, till the circular was issued, I mean, keeping the market off limits for players with less application money, probably even if you call it as a retail investor. So the thing is that there is a lot of risk associated with this 81 bonds because of the inherent nature of this instrument. So there were many cases where the investors themselves were, you know, sending information through WhatsApp to other investors, calling this as a super FD, super fixed deposit. And some 81 bonds, actually, some companies were unable to repay because this, the inherent nature of this instrument is whereby it gives a lot of flexibility to the banks to recall at any point in time, or, you know, early redemption and other issues. So this is a huge heavy risk instrument. So which is the reason why we have now brought in this circular saying that now it will be only applicable, the application lot, mandatory application lot, we made it 1 crore. We have made it, made QIBs to participate in the, you know, in the primary market. And in the secondary market, we have said that the market lot should be at least 1 crore, so which means that only people with that amount of money can participate. So there is one thing which I think recently, which I want to also clarify, which I read in the newspapers also, which was a little puzzling, is that what happens to the existing 81s, which, I mean, 81 bonds which have been issued before the circular. See, the existing 81 bonds, obviously you can't, if suppose I hold 81 bond, worth 2 lakhs, then I can't, you know, marginally scale up to, you know, 1 crore and then trade. I mean, that is common sense. So the existing bonds will obviously continue, will continue to trade at the same level. This will be applicable only from the, you know, the for the new issuances. Both the primary and the secondary market. That is something which I would like to clarify once again. I believe there is no ambiguity in the circular, but nonetheless, reading a couple of news articles, even one recently yesterday, which I went through it, I believe this needed a clarification. This it will apply for new issuances. So, and we have also made it compulsory for the bank issuer to give all the risk factors and the specific nature of these 81 instruments. See, there was a very good point which I read in one of the articles, which said that does not necessarily mean that in case I am a money bag, that is, in case I'm able to put in 1 crore, doesn't mean that I'm able to assimilate so many things, because a lot of investors are also able to put in so much money and still undertake the risk. That is a good point, not to obviously taking away from that. But the fact is that you have to read again. See, there is a proverb which says that, you know, you can only take the horse to the water, you can't make it drink. So we can only prescribe that there are certain rules, and because recently the Madras High Court ruled that in case of 81 bonds, there was a case which was made, and whereby there was a petition made to mandatorily make them repay the 81 bond thing, where the Madras High Court ruled that it applies, you know, it goes on in a, it happens in a buyer beware scenario. I mean, whereby obviously when you are going to do this, then you have to ensure that it is a buyer beware thing. So that doctrine applies to and it threw the case out. So that is again a testimony to the fact that you have to read, because it is a risk that which you are going to take. Okay, so then the other circular which we have issued recently, the new reform is again for the T+4 circular, which we have issued for the purpose of private placement basis. See, presently you have a T+6 thing for the public issues and in equity. So we thought now we'll try to bring this for private placement also, because there have been undue delays which happen after a point in time, and we have been receiving so many requests for exemptions, and we have been issuing warning letters to these companies. So we thought, instead of mentioning all this and to curtail these, and unless there is a genuine delay, in which case you can go ahead by paying a 1% interest, additional penal interest over the coupon rate from the date of allotment to the date of actual listing. So that is something which we have mentioned. So and we have to ensure that listing application and listing should be obtained by T+4 day. So this will be coming into effect from December 1, 2020. So I hope this will reduce all these cases of request for exemptions and all that. I have a small slide on green bonds, which I would like to say. Green bond is just another corporate bond, but it is in 2017 we introduced this because recently there is a lot of talk of sustainability, green borrowings, etc. So what do you mean by green borrowing is when you're going to borrow something for the purpose of utilizing it in a sustainable project or a green project, like clean energy, clean transportation, sustainable energy, sustainable waste management, you know, climate adaptation, etc. So then that is known as green bonds. So there are certain concessions which we have given in the green bond circular. So what I will do, and okay, there is something on municipal bonds. I think municipal bonds I've already talked about. So I'll stop here. So in case there are any questions, I can always take you. Thank you.
Thank you, Pradeep. Thank you very much. Now I will request Savitri to give industry prospects and her point of view on this particular topic.
Sure. Thank you, Pavan. Actually, there's some connectivity issue, which is the reason I've shifted to my phone. I hope this is fine. Okay. So Pavan, actually, in terms of the changes, as I was mentioning, it is incremental changes which have been made, but in terms of depth, it certainly is one which will bring in a lot more transparency. And as Pradeep was also mentioning, they've made the market one where there would be enough information given to the prospective investors who are investing in bonds. For example, they have brought in a little more discipline with respect to the asset cover, security creation. For example, on security creation, one of the duties of the debenture trustee would be to ensure that the assets would be to ensure that before creating security, the debenture trustees should do a due diligence on the security to see whether it is free from all encumbrances. And if indeed the assets have been given as security to any other party, then whether the letter ceding a second charge or ceding a pari passu charge has been obtained or not. And this is also required to be clearly covered in the offer document or in the information memorandum or the disclosure document, as the case may be. Because Schedule 1 of ILDS has also been correspondingly amended, where there is a line item covering this. So in terms of industry perspective, I would say the compliances have gone up, the disclosure requirements have gone up, and it certainly is one where if you are completely compliant, it is just an additional disclosure which you need to do. And the responsibility of the debenture trustees has certainly gone up. The duties and obligations have gone up, as I was mentioning a little while ago, the quarterly compliances and half yearly compliances. Quarterly, it is actually on the trustees to be doing it. So that's broadly what it is with respect to the entire interplay of all three. If I were to dissect it, of course, I covered with respect to debenture trustee regulations. If I were to look at it from the LODR perspective, regulation 54 and 56 have undergone change. 54 is all about asset cover, which we covered a little while ago with respect to 100% or 100% as is required for satisfying the principal and interest, which was always there in LODR also. But what it now reads is 100% or as is mentioned in the offer document or information memorandum or in the debenture trust deed. And as I mentioned a little while ago, according to me, it can only be upwards. It cannot be lower than 100%, mainly because of Section 71 of the Companies Act. Regulation 54, sub-regulation 3, which was earlier there in LODR, has been deleted. Regulation 54.3 was a carve-out with respect to financially regulated entities, which basically is non-banking finance companies. And they were not covered under this asset cover requirement under LODR, which by virtue of this deletion of 54.3, and actually there's another corresponding deletion even in 54, regulation 56, along with 54. So because of that, the concession which was earlier there, the carve-out which was earlier there, is now no longer available. Regulation 56 is all about disclosures and intimations to the debenture trustees by the listed entity concerned. Of course, there's another important point of listed entity and listed company, as has been amended in the Companies Amendment Act of 2020, but I would not touch upon it right now unless there are specific queries on this. Now, with respect to intimation to debenture trustees, there is a further point which has been added in 56.1.4 with respect to the covenants, including all side letters or accelerated payment clauses, etc., to be disclosed to the debenture trustees, which means the debenture trustees would need to have information about the side letters which may have been executed by the company during the tenure of the debentures. 56.1.D, which we actually covered in the debenture trustee regulations, a similar one has been provided over here with respect to half-yearly certificate of statutory auditors, which is required to be given, which earlier was from a practicing CS or a practicing CA. And even in this particular provision, earlier there was a carve-out with respect to banks and NBFCs, which were not required to comply with this. And also there was a carve-out with respect to bonds which are secured by the central government. Now, bonds which are secured by the government still enjoy the benefit, but banks and financial institutions will no longer enjoy this particular benefit, which actually means the half-yearly certificate from statutory auditors will be applicable to banks and financial institutions, non-banking financial companies also. Changes in ILDS, corresponding changes, but I would just like to touch upon a couple of them. Private placement has been brought in sync with Section 42. There is a clear reference to Section 42. Earlier, there was a reference to the number of persons to whom the issue could be made, which was 50 as per the pre-amended provision, which has now been clearly aligned with 42, where it says private placement would basically mean what is covered in Section 42 of the Companies Act. Then with respect to Regulation 15.2, there's a reference to the trust deed. And as I mentioned in the debenture trustee regulations, where it says it will be as is required in SH12, read with Section 71. And as I explained, it will have the trust deed will have two parts, Part A, Part B. Same provision is also covered in ILDS. So there is a similar provision in debenture trustee regulations as well as in ILDS. Regulation 18.2 with respect to rollover, this is a welcome provision. Earlier, it required a 21 days notice. That has been reduced to 15 days. 21A with respect to creation of security, an undertaking needs to be given by the issuer that the assets are free from encumbrances, or consent of the security holder for creation of second charge or pari passu charge, as the case may be, which should have been obtained, and it should also be covered in the undertaking in the document concerned. There is a recovery expense fund which needs to be created, which is Regulation 26.7. It's important to note that 26 is all about public issues. So probably the intention is to create this recovery expense fund only with respect to public issues. And similarly, there are other changes made to Schedule 1. Now, Schedule 1, as you know, is about disclosures which are required to be covered. And it's also important to note that what Anjali was covering with respect to private placements, private placement of debentures also, the reference is to Schedule 1. So all the disclosures given in Schedule 1 need to be made even in case of a private placement, which actually is a disclosure document. In fact, if you see the names of the documents, one is offer document or an information memorandum. These are applicable only to public issues or offer for sale, and disclosure document, which is applicable to private placements. So private placement documents are disclosure documents containing the same disclosures as are given in Schedule 1. Event of default, or all covenants of the issue, which needs to be clearly mentioned, including side letters, accelerated payments, voting agreements in the event of a default. If there are any conditions with respect to the inter-creditor agreement, that's required to be disclosed. Creation of the recovery expense fund, which actually is applicable only with respect of public issues, as I mentioned a little while ago, public issue or offer for sale, and conditions for breach of covenants against which this fund can be dipped into. Security disclosure requirements have gone up, where in case of a security, whether it's a hypothecation or a mortgage, what is the kind of asset on which the security is being created? Is it movable, immovable, intangible, tangible, as the case may be? Date of creation of security. Of course, date of creation of security will apply only with respect to public issues or offer for sale. And these are also required to be mentioned, as well as risk factors of the issue needs to be disclosed. So in a nutshell, these are the additional ones. And I think Anjali, Pradeep, and me have covered the broad areas which are required to be considered. Of course, Pradeep's presentation was far more elaborate, where he covered about other issues also and also gave his perspective. And over to you, Pawan.
Thank you, Savitri. Thank you very much. Now, friends, it's a time of Q&A. And we have received 466 questions. And then 40 questions we have received yesterday. So now we have 100 questions. So my request to all the participants that be brief, because our aim is to clear all the doubts. And these questions which people are asking, it's not in detail, or we can cover it faster. Now I'm starting with Savitri, with you. Is it mandatory to list the NCD under SEBI regulation by both listed and unlisted entity? Can a company issue secured unlisted NCD?
Absolutely, yes. You can certainly issue secured unlisted NCDs. And if you are issuing unlisted NCDs, as Anjali mentioned, bear in mind, if it is unlisted, unsecured, it will become a deposit. And your question is, can you issue secured unlisted so that it is outside the purview of deposits? Go ahead, no problem at all.
Okay, Savitri, Anjali, both. Because deposits definition and the definition of NCD, there is a some issue where if you are not following. So what are the difference between deposit and NCD?
Anjali, would you like to go first? Go ahead.
Again, as Savitri said, if the NCDs are list secured, they will not, if they are secured NCDs, listed NCDs, they will not fall within the ambit of deposits. But if they are not listed and unsecured, they will fall within the ambit of deposits. To be complied with, we have to comply with the provisions of deposit rules.
Okay. Okay. Now, my next question is to Savitri. Now, this just now, you have covered REF, okay?
Right.
This Recovery Expenses Fund. Now, some people are asking this question. This REF fund is, this is effective from 1st January.
That's
and
right.
In addition, window of 90 days is also given for existing outstanding issue as on the date. What will be the impact of this circular on NCD issuance, listing of which is in process? Application for in-principle approval is made and 90 days will be reckoned from the which date? January 1st or date of circular?
Well, I don't think the circular is clear on this, but logically I would say if your issue, if you have already, let's say for example, if it's a private placement and you're opening the issue after 1st of Jan, private placements in any case are not governed by this, so there is no problem at all. Let's assume it is a public issue that you're making, then in that case, once your documents are filed with the stock exchange and you've got the in-principle approval and everything is moving as per the calendar, I would say logically you would be exempted. Only issues which are now being filed will be the ones which will have to comply if they are opening their issue after 1st of Jan. However, I would also ask Pradeep to supplement this.
Pradeep is joining back. Savitri, is the requirement of REF applicable on private placement or NCD?
In my opinion, no. Because the regulation 26.7, which deals with REF, is actually one which deals with, which is falling under public issue or offer for sale. And private placement is a separate section in itself. And all that ILDS says is that you need to comply with disclosure requirements as are given in Schedule 1. Now, this ambiguity has arisen because in Schedule 1, there is a reference to REF, but it's actually not applicable in case of a private placement.
Okay. Anjali, can a newly incorporated company satisfy the listing criteria, can list the entity issue in the private placement basis?
No, as Pradeep mentioned, that if the company needs to have 3 years of audited accounts, then only the company can get listed.
Okay, that question, when Pradeep will come, I will ask a supplement question. Okay, Savitri, any company, public sector undertake, what types of companies can list NCD on a stock exchange?
So even a private company can list its NCDs on the stock exchange. There is no bar whatsoever. In fact, if you refer to the provisions of Companies Amendment Act of 2020, it actually has... There is a provision to redefine the term listed companies, and I'm reasonably sure private companies which have listed debentures, probably there would be a carve out bringing them outside the purview.
Okay, Anjali, can a company issue debenture in physical form?
No, mandatory DMAT.
Okay, Savitri, what is the rationale behind the SEBI circular authorizing one trustee to get the trustees to get details access of the company's bank account from the payment of interest principal is made?
Yeah, so actually this is a new requirement, and this is mainly to ensure that there is a standing instruction and authority given to the trustees to directly dip into this particular account and make payments. And whenever there are changes to the account, of course there is a flexibility. One can certainly make a change, but the trustees would have the authority to directly make payments if the company has not made payment. That is exactly the reason why this is required to be given as per SEBI circular.
Okay, Anjali, what are the benefits of unlisted NCD over listed NCD? Why to go for listing of NCD? This question, first you tell, then Savitri can add.
Why to go for listing? As I told in my PPT as well, that best part is that the debentures can be traded on the stock exchange just like equity or any other security. That gives the investor a lot of flexibility. And secondly, instead of being just redeemed, the investor can sell to the other people, can trade.
Savitri, you want to add something?
So actually, the only other flexibility would be you can actually go through the whole process pretty quickly. For example, if the issue is of an amount exceeding 200 crores, you would necessarily have to go through the EBP platform if you are proposing to list. And listing, giving all the details and getting the approval will definitely take one or two more days. So if it's only one single entity who's going to invest, having unlisted secured NCDs is one which can be very easily arranged. So therefore, there is an advantage there. But otherwise, it actually depends on who's going to be investing. And based on that, you would be able to take a call.
Okay. Anjali. You want to
add one more thing. As per the last year's circular of October, the mutual funds have been mandated to invest only in listed commercial papers and listed NCDs. So that again is one of the major reasons why the mutual funds are mandating that the company should go in for listing.
Simple logic is that listing creates liquidity, and liquidity creates more investors. That is the best part, and it can change hand without any problem, because otherwise this will be a problem. Okay, Anjali, is appointment...
Also, there is a lot more of transparency if it is listed.
Yeah. Okay. Anjali, is appointment of debenture trustee mandatory?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
And who can be appointed debenture trustee?
The entity has to be registered with SEBI.
Yeah.
That's the basic requirement. And then SEBI has its own debenture trustee regulations as well.
Okay. Okay. Savitri, does the company require to file the disclosure document with the ROC?
No, disclosure document is not required to be filed with the ROC.
Okay. Anjali, mostly this has been observed that NCD are listed with BSE, mostly not NSE. What is the reason?
Probably because NSE has additional set of compliances or requirements, eligibility requirements. So that is why many of the companies feel easy to get listed on BSE.
Savitri, you have any other point related?
No, nothing further on that, no.
Okay. Savitri, Anjali, is it minimum subscription requirement is 75% in public issue of NCD?
Sir, as per the ICD, as per the debt listing regulations, there is no provision for minimum subscription. But there is a circular which talks about, circular of 2014, which talks about minimum subscription. The same amendment is not there in the listing in the debt listing regulations. So this needs some clarity.
Okay. Savitri, is it mandatory to obtain credit rating for listed debenture?
Absolutely. And the credit rating should not be more than 30 days old.
Okay. Is the debenture redemption reserve is mandatory?
So debenture redemption reserve, there have been several relaxations which have been granted in rule 18, subrule 7. So going by that, if it's a listed company, you're not required to have, you're not required to create a debenture redemption reserve. Even in case of private placement, if it's a listed company, it's not required. So it's only unlisted companies that you will be required to create debenture redemption reserve, as well as make investments of not less than 15% of the debentures falling due for redemption during the year and the following year.
Okay. Anjali.
And MCA has also come up with a relaxation granting time right up to 31st of December this year because of COVID.
Shortly, just tell how to create DRR.
It's basically DRR is an appropriation from the profits of the company and it cannot be used for any other purpose except for redemption of the debentures.
Okay. Pradeep, in case of any inadvertent non-compliance debt chapter of LODR, is there any remedy available for condonation of default? Your voice, please, you're mute.
See, unlike the equity portion of the LODR, where there is an SOP, the standard operating procedure, as of now, there is no standard operating procedure for debt, though we must be working on it. So if there is an inadvertent non-compliance, you can write to SEBI, we can see what we can do about it.
Okay. Anjali, is it mandatory for private company to convert itself into public company for listing or NCD through private?
No.
Savitri. SEBI, by this notification dated October 8th, has amended Regulation 56.1D of SEBI LODR. You must be knowing 56.1D, okay?
Yes.
Of LODR. Whether statutory auditor are required to certify covenants relating to monitoring of asset cover for all covenants of IM and DTD.
All covenants of IM, debenture trust deed, as well as offer document, as the case may be, will all need to be covered. So in case it's one where it was a public issue, you would have the offer document as well as the DTD. In case there's something more which is given in the DTD, all that will have to be covered.
Okay. Pradeep, what is the rationale behind SEBI circular authorizing the trustee to get details? Access of the company's bank account and the payment of interest principal is made.
What is the rationale? I'm unable to comprehend the question.
Okay. Anjali, are there any prerequisite for a private company for listing their NCD vis-a-vis paid up capital criteria or net worth criteria or any other criteria?
BSE does not have any such requirements. NSE has a set of requirements, as I mentioned in the PPT as well.
Okay. Savitri, do we need to have both disclosure document and PSA 4, or we can cover all the requirement of PSA 4 in disclosure document?
Cover all the requirements of PAS 4 in the disclosure document itself, because it will just be few more additional disclosures. Cover it in the disclosure document itself and have just one.
Okay. Pradeep, this respect to SEBI October 22nd circular, wherein SEBI has mandated creation of REF. Is this apply only to secured debenture?
I think it should apply to all.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. That's right.
Savitri, when should the PSA 4 be issued, whether after the bidding is over and the participants are known or at the time of letter offer itself?
So it will be at the stage where in case of a private placement, letter of offer is in case of a rights issue. disclosure document needs to be uploaded on the EBP platform, post which you have participation, you know, you have the bidders, and post that you would be sending out the PASS4 with PPOAL, that is the application form also, to the named persons. That's when you send this out.
Okay.
So I just wanted to add a point to the earlier question that you had asked, probably, you know, from what I comprehended. But see, the thing is, recently, I'm just giving you a broad perspective about the debenture trustees thing, because we have been bringing certain amendments as far as debenture trustees are concerned. So largely, we want the debenture trustees to play a larger role. I mean, that is from where all these things are coming. And to play a larger role, the debenture trustee needs to be equipped with information and details. So whenever we have had interactions with the debenture trustees, they have been saying that we need an enabling provision for, you know, for collection of information so that we'll be able to perform our duties better. So that is from where this new thing, because in case I am to monitor, then I have to be also be armed with, you know, information.
Okay. Savitri, in case of private company, due to listing, the bond was sold to the investor, to other investor, and the number rose to 200, more than 200. Because the restriction is private companies 200 in one financial year. Does this violate the number of prescribed under Companies Act?
Yes, it will then be violative of persons in the Companies Act. But what is important is at the stage of issuance, it should not have more than 50 or more than 200. And if it is listed, you will definitely have more number thereafter. But at the initial stage, when you're offering, it should not exceed the numbers as are given in 42.
But what is my control if I'm, because it is listed and anybody can buy?
After it is listed, it's different, because 42 is all about initial offer that you're making.
Okay. Okay. So after that, it can become more.
Yeah.
Okay. Anjali, is ROC approval still required for self-prospectus in light of recent amendment in Companies Act?
Let me just add one more point. Sorry to go back. In fact, if it's a portfolio management CA scheme which has invested, as an investor, it will appear as one. While once the portfolio management scheme gets the allotment, the shares or the securities actually get credited to those respective persons who are in the PMS. So that will also actually increase the number, but that's a gray area as we speak today. Over to you, Pavan. Sorry to have interrupted.
Okay. Anjali, is ROC approval still required for self-prospectus in light of recent amendment in Companies Act?
I think it's required.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is as per Rule 18 required to sign debenture trustee deed within 3 months instead of 2 months? Can the power be delegated by board as per Regulation 179?
It can be.
Okay. Pradeep, do we require in-principle approval for issue on private placement basis? Is it not mentioned in Regulation 20 of Debt Listing Regulation?
Yeah, you need in-principle approval, obviously.
Okay, Pradeep.
You need, yeah.
Okay, you are new in this department, so some technical and process.
Yeah, please don't. There are experts.
I'm not asking. Yeah, so you can pass on to Savitri and Anjali.
Yeah, thanks.
Because we know Pradeep is a circular man. He understands the problem of the industry and then he solved this. And because in your absence, Pradeep, I was telling that in COVID time, you have removed so many problems of the industry. Okay, what are the criteria appointment of debenture trustee in case of issue of NCD? Anjali?
It should be registered with SEBI, sir. There are no requirements.
Okay. Because I have received so many questions on this particular electronic process. So since NCD are issued at face value, what is the significance of EBM, electronic book mechanism, Savitri?
Sorry, I could not hear your question. Can you just repeat it once again?
I think Pradeep or Savitri both can give. Since NCD are issued at face value, what is the significance of electronic book mechanism?
Basically, electronic book mechanism would ensure that there is a transparent mechanism for bidding. Yes, price discovery is one part of it, but even in terms of participation, in case of EBP, even a QIB can participate. Therefore, you know, there is a equal opportunity given to these people to participate. That's the way I look at it. Pradeep, if you want
to ask. I just like to, I think ma'am, you have hit the nail right on the head. See, the thing is, we want to, give as much fillip to the corporate bond market. The electronic, book mechanism, completely reduces the opacity and increases the transparency. So it helps. Of course, it will help in price discovery over a period of time. But like Madam rightly said, I think we want a lot of people to participate. This will give you a lot of the opportunity to more people to participate, which is what we want.
Okay, Pradeep or Savitri and Anjali, we have received around 20 questions on EBPM because there's a new concept. So I'm going for rapid round. So you have to just give yes and no. Okay, Pradeep, what is the EBP platform?
I think I explained it. I mean, it's a transparent mechanism for price discovery.
So, Savitri, it is applicable to all issue of NCD which are proposed to be listed?
Over 200 crores.
Okay.
And only private placements.
Yeah. Okay.
What is PPM, private placement memorandum, offer document information, Anjali?
The offer document which is circulated to all the share, all the proposed investors and uploaded on the ebook mechanism.
Pradeep, what is the prerequisite for availing EBP platform?
What do you mean by prerequisite? Prerequisite is you apply to the exchanges and you...
Okay.
You should have been registered as an issuer only after that can you upload.
Yeah.
Savitri, who can act as an arranger?
Anjali, I would pass on that question to you because you've been doing it.
Merchant bankers and registered entities with SEBI.
Okay.
All registered entities. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Savitri, who are bidders participant in electronic book mechanism?
So bidders could be QIBs. You could have banks, mutual funds participating, and it can also be any other company, provided it is registered as a entity entitled to participate in bids.
Okay, Pradeep, who has accessed these issue-specific information?
Issue-specific information the exchanges will have because they are going to collect the information on the bids, etc.
Okay. Anjali, what is the role of exchange and clearing corporation in this?
Exchange is the platform through which we take the ebook mechanism, ebook platform, and the issuer has to get registered with the exchange so that it can come out with the issue on the exchange, and the bidders also have to be registered with the exchange.
Savitri, is it mandatory for all the investors to register themselves with the EBP platform?
All the persons participating, yes. If they have to register, only then they'll be able to participate because they have to log in and then participate.
Pradeep, is it not increasing the time because it the process stays?
No, certainly not. It in fact reduces the time.
Okay. So Anjali, what is the minimum amount of bid size?
Minimum amount of bid size, I'll have to check. Maybe Pradeep can.
That will differ from issue to issue. There is no compulsion.
Okay.
It's like something like an 81 instrument or something like that. There is no problem, I think.
Okay. Savitri, whether issuer can use uniform or multiple price method for allotment?
So, yeah, actually in the same series, you can actually have different tranches. And in different tranches, you may have floating and a fixed coupon rate, in which case the price discovery will be different.
Pradeep, how the bidding is taking place in EBP platform?
Once you log in and register, then whatever it's open, you can always place in the bid that you want.
So I can modify and cancel the bid also?
So no, modification of bid is allowed only if you are going to withdraw and then place it again, unlike the equity mechanism.
Okay. Anjali, will the details are available on EBP website post-allotment?
Post-allotment, no.
Okay. Savitri, what is the responsibility of issuer, arranger, and investor?
So, issuer is the person who has to upload all the documents and ensure that, you keep a tab thereafter. And also, there's another important point. You can actually have a green shoe option. So, in the EBP platform, you get this flexibility with respect to the green shoe option as to how much has been subscribed taken up by the parties concerned.
Anjali, how the basis of allotment is decided under EBP mechanism?
I want to add one point also to what Madam has said. Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, no problem.
I think one important responsibility of the investor which we have been harping upon is to read the offer document.
Okay. Okay. Can the issuer withdraw the issue after citing up same on the platform?
No, I don't think so.
Okay. How then when the payment is being done by the investor?
Payment is done through the settlement mechanism where, payment comes into the stock exchange, and after you filed your pass through the return of allotment, you would be applying to the depository. Post that, the money will come to you. So okay. The process is very, very smooth.
Okay. Anjali, what is the stamp duty implication?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
What are the stamp duty implication on NCD?
Stamp duty is to be paid through the NSDL now.
Okay. Savitri, in case company having listed, NCD going for, in the case company going for merger or demerger for any modification in the listed debenture, what approvals they required?
So typically in the debenture trust deed, there is a carve out which says that if there is a reorganization, approval of the debenture holders will be required. So therefore, it will be treated as secured, unsecured debentures as the case may be, and a court convened meeting will be called even with respect to these debenture holders. Of course, there's also a provision for taking approval in writing. So, you know, if the number of debenture holders are small, you might even get a letter from them based on which you can get dispensation for holding the meeting of the debenture holders.
Okay. I think this is just technically whether statutory auditor certificate for security cover will be applicable for half year from October 1st, 2020 onwards, or whether we can give CA certificate for the compliance relating to first half financial 2020 till September 30th, 2020.
Unless there is a clarification issued by SEBI, I would say that companies who had not completed their meeting by the 8th of October will have to comply with this.
Savitri, SEBI is sitting here, you can ask her.
I've given the lead.
Anjali, in case of issuance of listed debenture, the security shall be created upfront, or can be security be created within a period of 60 days?
Security has to be created upfront. The details have to be given in the placement document.
Okay, now.
If it is a public issue or an offer for sale, yes, it has to be created upfront.
Okay.
In case of private placement, it is later.
We have crossed our time, 15 minutes, but all the people, I think 251 people are still there and they are sending questions. So I'm just continuing for 15 more minutes.
Pavan, I will have to drop off. So
I'll have to go.
I can just go quickly. You have to go for 6. So 5:55 will close it.
No. Pavan, I would be able to be there only for another 3 minutes. 5:50, I will have to log off.
I had a meeting. I had a phone call at 5:30. I pushed it to 5:45.
Okay. In light
last
of...
Last question, please.
Okay. Whether NCD issue on FPI be unsecured?
Okay, that's an easy one. We will have another conference where we address this.
Okay. Pradeep, can you continue for a few more minutes?
No, only one question.
What is material price sensitive information which is required to be disclosed for only debt listed companies?
No, what is material price sensitive information would be something which is going to impact the price. So that's everything that is you are going to determine as per the scheme of materiality is indeed material price sensitive information.
Okay, one question has come specific to you. I have a question. The banks, NBC, are issuing bonds in the nature of debenture on the private placement basis for capital at purpose. But later bonds are being down sold by broker, and within 1 year, the list of bonds holder is touching 2,000 as against the original allotment. Mm-hmm. Neither the broker are educating and this end point. The debenture holders are also, and this is also written off by RBI. Any innovation, tip way to fixing the short term's complexity?
No. I think this is again on the 81 bonds. I think it's connected to the 81 bonds issue. See, the 81 bonds, of course, now we have made it inaccessible for people with a lower bid, because this is precisely the reason. The whole mis-selling or whatever that has happened is also, I would also attribute a mis-selling to a mis-buying. In as much that you don't read what is being sold to you. So in this case, what has happened is that the banks have sold the bonds specifically mentioning about because when you read the terms of the offer document before investing, you will be able to know, because that 81 bonds contain certain rules and regulations which are very intrinsic to those, which give the power of the bank to recall, redeem, or early redemption, or even write them off and consultation with the RBI. And that is the reason why we have this point of non-viability clause, which is there in any 81 document. So I would say that now that's the reason we have issued a circular where we have mentioned that up to 1 crore, the 1 crore and above is what we will have to apply. And the trading lot also is 1 crore. So this, I think, will certainly keep away the so-called retail investors.
Okay, Savitri and Prateep, because I can ask, continue asking question from Anjali. I have to just close by asking two, three things. I think recently we have seen the web series of Harshad Mehta. I think that has come in the web series. And if you see the web series, you will realize that there was a financial market, and the financial market was controlled by few brokers or few people, few banks. Now, if you see the story of the bond market also, I have just seen this, and I show where you were not there that time. I gave a presentation, and in that we have given a data that private placement is more than the public issues in the bond market. Now, in corporate bond, SDI, municipal bond, GSEC, SLD, treasury bill, CP, CD, so many things are there. And then now government has also prescribed that all big companies, they have to bring out 25% bond. So now the question is, because now I'm sure that you have come in this department, so you'll make this department more activated. So do you think that this market is still confined to few players? Number one. Number two, education is very less. Number three, entry restriction is there. Small investors are not going because of the complex and the compliance process is cumbersome. Something is there. So if you can add some point and tell us, and my request is that this market is giving a good return as compared to so many other things. As an investor, I have only one option, to go to the FD. But if you have these all options where the night money can also earn money for you, why people are not going there? Because the system is not easy. What is your view on this?
Sorry, I will have to drop off. Thank you very much. It's really been wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you, Savitri.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, this is a very good question, but I would also like to, I mean, of course, I have come to this department. I should also acknowledge the contribution of my predecessor, Ms. Richa, who has done a fabulous job over the past 3-4 years in this department. See, we have been taking a lot of steps as far as the bond market is concerned, right from uniform price valuation to, you know, lower rated bonds and, you know, information to investors and other things. If you see, look at the bond regulation, the ILDS as well as the LODR related issues for bonds are actually a lot more light touch as compared to, you know, an equity instrument. We don't even issue observations on bond offer documents, because the fact is that once a person is, in case of a bond, there is always a guarantee that it will be repaid. As against equities, so that is an issue. Now, bond is an instrument which has to be understood, because this is—it's not only in India; it's all over the world. The corporate bond market is a lot different from the equity market. The vibrancy in the equity market is not comparable to that of a bond market. The bond market is—it's very less, because one is normally, if you see the typical mentality of a person investing in a bond is that it is going to be an yield to maturity. I'm going to invest in this, and after the end of the period, I'm going to receive interest every year, and after the end of it, it's going to be paid back. So, but this is something which you will have to, over a period of time, you'll have to inculcate the thing of investing in bonds and also trading in bonds. Not only investment, it's also trading in bonds. But I believe we have taken a lot of steps recently, and these steps will continue not only by SEBI, including RBI and even the other regulators. If you look at IRDA and PFRDA, they also mandated their regulated entities to, you know, invest in corporate bonds, increase in you know, the rated instruments, etc. So this is something our efforts towards this will continue. And if you look at the collections which I have shown you in my slides, it has actually increased over a period of time, and it will only increase over a period of time. But the one thing which I have been harping upon even when I was handling equity is that the investor has to read the document. There should be a lot more understanding of how bond market works. I believe the RFQ and the EBP mechanisms, which are a lot more transparent, which bring in, which remove the opacity, they will add a further fillip, and they go a long way in improving the collections in the bond market, the trading in the bond market, and investor participation in the bond market.
Pradeep, my last request to you, because this market is very big, and Indian share as compared to international market is very poor. Okay, I was just mentioning in the beginning that international, the entire world market is very big. There's
it is
28.3 trillion dollar market is there. Indian market is only 2.94 trillion. And out of this, there only 67% Indian market is 67% of GDP. So you can understand that we have a huge scope. Even the Malaysia has a 46%, India has only 16% of GDP in bond market. So you have a long way to go, and you can have so many things you can work out. My only suggestion is that we are requesting all the participants, if they can send a suggestion how the ordinary people can invest, because India 32% we are having a saving rate, and 32% we are investing only in gold or NFT, and then we are going for property. And if we can create this, that this is the market where you can do. So I think from the side of everybody, I will request you that you make this market in a way that each and everybody who has a money, who can invest very simplified way, it should not be the market of very big people, because there is a need of money, there is a return. It's a cost of, because only thing is cost of collection is reduced by the system. So we can work out something. So I think, thank you very much, Pradeep, for giving this. And we will also close this session here. I think we have received various questions. What we will do, as we are doing, we were not expecting this type of response from the people side, but we have received. So thank you very much to all. We will send you the reply. Whatever, Pradeep, we will take your help to communicate properly some questions which we want to create.
Certainly, suggestions are always welcome.
Yeah, we can do it.
On post-listing space.
So friends, thank you very much. And I will request everybody that next Friday, we have a very, very interesting session. And Mr. V.S. Sundaresan, who is the Executive Director of SEBI, he is addressing on corporate frauds in Indian securities market. And he is covering the live some case studies on market manipulation, insider trading, and front running. So I will request all of you to join this. The link we have given, you can join. And on next day, on Saturday, this is for the purpose of, because everybody is working out on succession planning, how to write bill and how to this. Dr. R.K. Agrawal will address on succession planning, the entire gamut of Hindu Succession Act. What is succession planning? What are the tax issue? How to maintain this? How to plan this? So Friday, Saturday, we have two programs. I will request all of you to join these programs. It will be very useful and very enriching. Thank you very much to all for participating. Thank you, Anjali. Thank you, Pradeep.
Thank you. Thank you.
They have done, and we will compile all the questions and make an FAQ, send it to all participants. Some questions which we are not able to give answer because of paucity of time, we will ensure that you will get the answer either by Savitri or by Pradeep. We will do this work. Thank you very much. Thank you for joining in large number. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Take care.